of ISCI, the International State Crime Initiative. I'm Balsam Smits-Legas. I'm the head of the Department of Law here at Queen Mary, and I'm really delighted to be able to welcome you here and to open this lecture. ISCI has been with us for about 2 years. It seems longer because, you know, it's a super active center. I think we're delighted to have them here. It's a fantastic team of colleagues and scholars and activists, so, you know, many hats, we are really delighted that we are able to facilitate their success. It's a hugely impactful center, and each of the colleagues individually is very, very interesting. We're delighted to have with us Professor Daniel Feierstein, one of the leading lights in genocide research, to give this lecture. I will not say much about him, but my colleague Penny Green, the director of ISCI, is going to introduce our speaker. So thank you very much.
Welcome, everybody. This is actually the 6th annual lecture for the International State Crime Initiative. So, and it's our 2nd at Queen Mary, where we are hugely delighted to be now located. And I have particular pleasure in introducing tonight's speaker, Professor Daniel Feierstein. Daniel is a scholar, an Argentinian scholar, who really is, as Valsalma said, a leading light in the world of genocide. And it's particularly important for those of us at ISCI to have Daniel here this year, because Daniel's work was absolutely influential in our own work on the genocide against the Rohingya in Burma. And we used Daniel's theoretical framework combined with our own state crime framework to make sense of the persecution that the Rohingya are experiencing at the hands of the Burmese state. So we owe Daniel an enormous scholarly debt, an enormous intellectual debt. And so Daniel has a very distinguished career. He's currently a researcher at Argentina's National Scientific and Technical Research Council. He's a senior lecturer at the National University of University, and the University of Buenos Aires. He directs the UN TREF Center for Genocide Studies, the first genocide studies research center in the whole of Latin America, and it was founded in 2007. And he's also the founder of the genocide chair at the University of Buenos Aires in 2001. And Daniel's work, and this book is particularly influential, Genocide as Social Practice, looks at the lessons from the Holocaust and also Argentina's dirty war, not normally understood in terms of a genocidal framework. So fantastically important comparative study. So I won't speak any longer, Daniel, but just to say how thrilled we are to have you here. And I would urge all of you to go out and buy Genocide as Social Practice, Reorganising Society Under Nazism and Argentina's Military Juntas, 2014 publication. You've also been very, very active, of course, in the Permanent People's Tribunals, but perhaps you can say a little bit about that later. But without any further ado, thank you very much, and welcome, Daniel.
Thank you. Okay. Thank you, Penny and the team, and thank you, Mary University, for the invitation to be here. My idea today is to talk a little bit about possibility to understand genocide as a technology of power. So trying to go beyond this idea of genocide as a production of death, and trying to understand the objectives, the social and political objectives of genocide, particularly modern genocide. And I will start with a very short but very enlightened sentence, which is in an Argentine theater play, and which says, "For each one we touch, 1,000 paralyzed with fear, we act by irradiation." It is in an Argentine theater play that was created before the Argentine dictatorship. But it was a visionary, really visionary. Tato Pavlovsky is the name of the author. And he understood the process even before it was done. And the idea of the sentence is to express in a nutshell how terror operates in a concentration camp society. This idea that for one touch, 1,000 paralyzed. That's the main way in which this technology of power works. Touching some people to paralyze and terrorize the whole society. So the idea is to understand this technology of power, mainly working with examples from Nazism, some examples from the Argentine case, some other examples, but to be able to develop an understanding and a theoretical framework that could be useful to be applied in many genocides, many modern genocides, particularly during the 20th and 21st century, particularly after the Second World War. So, as a paradigmatic case of genocide, Nazi genocide provides a good example of how different interpretations can promote ownership of experience or conversely alienation of experience. The hegemonic way of thinking about the Nazi genocide, and I would say about the rest of the genocides too, is in terms of the Jewish and Roma communities annihilated in Germany, Poland, and Lithuania. So the idea that the Jews and the Roma were annihilated by the perpetrators who were Germans, Poles, Lithuanians. So when stripped of their citizenship, Jews and Gypsies could no longer be seen as Germans, Poles, or Lithuanians, or even as Europeans. Once Nazism became a Europe-wide ideology during World War II, accordingly, ordinary Germans, Poles, and Lithuanians seem to have remained largely indifferent to the fate of the victims, except for possible feelings of solidarity. So the victims are not part of themselves. So they could feel some solidarity or not, but it is something to happen to others. So such black and white binary ways of thinking not only assign entire groups of people to the category of either perpetrators or victims, but assume that these groups have enduring and stable characteristics. These assumptions deny the complexity of the historical processes involved, as well as ignoring the dynamic and artificial nature of identity construction. On the contrary, if we are able to understand the Nazi genocide as also a partial destruction of the German, Polish, or Lithuanian national groups, we could reinstate the victims as full citizens and confront the goals of Nazism, which proposed the need for a Reich Juden Reich, so Reich without Jews. The aim of Nazism was not only to exterminate certain groups, ethnic, national, and political, among others, but to transform German and European society through the absence of such groups. A transformation that, in the event, proved to be quite successful, even beyond the defeat of Nazism. In particular, one of the most enduring effects of the Nazi genocide in Europe was the disappearance of internationalism, plurality, and cosmopolitanism as constituent parts of German and European identity. And it was a consequence of Nazism. Indeed, what tends to remain hidden in discussions of the Nazi genocide and other historical cases of genocide is that the perpetrators and victims previously shared a community as Ottomans, Germans, Poles, Rwandans, or Yugoslavs. It is precisely this plural identity that genocide seeks to destroy and replace with a uniform identity. Aryan Germans, Ottoman Turkish Muslims, Rwandan Hutus, and so on. Identities can be radically transformed, as in Argentina, Chile, Cambodia, or Indonesia, or directly eliminated, as in former Yugoslavia, where identity is only readable now as Serbian, Croatian, Bosnian, Kosovar, Macedonian. And the previous Yugoslav identity can no longer be remembered, let alone reconstructed. Thus, the identity that remains hidden is precisely the one the perpetrator sought to annihilate and replace with this binary opposition model of the so-called pre-existing identities, such as Germans versus Jews, Armenian versus Turks, or Hutus versus Tutsis. The hegemonic view of the Nazi genocide has tended to overlook its preparatory stage. That's what in which I will focus. In Nazism, I will focus more in the 30s than in the 40s, because the 40s are not understandable without the 30s, but the 30s usually have been forgotten or hidden. So, to understand what happened from 1933 to 1938, I mean, it's fundamental to understand Nazism as a technology of power. Because in that moment, we can see the deployment of terror in the whole German society. One of the best authors dealing with the period is Robert J. Lately. And Robert J. Lately distinguishes four stages in that period, 1933-1938. The first period, 1933-1934, communists and members of other leftist political parties were placed in preventive custody. In other words, they were imprisoned without trial in concentration camps. They lately estimated that about 100,000 prisoners passed through these camps, of which over 65% were members of the German Communist Party. Between 500 and 600 inmates were killed in these 2 years by summary executions or as a result of living conditions in the camps. But 500 to 600 out of 100,000. So what happened to the rest? The rest came back to the German society with this consequence. For one, we touch 1,000 paralyzed by fear. So the second stage, the first stage was the political persecution one, 1933-1934. Second stage, after the drastic reduction in the use of concentration camps during 1935 and much of 1936, at the end of 1936, the Nazis found a new target, the asocial. So Dr. Bernard Best, a lawyer and a chief legal advisor to the Gestapo, define asocial as every attempt to impose or maintain any theory besides National Socialism, which was a symptom of sickness which threatens the healthy unity of the indivisible whole organism. In his instructions to the Kripo, the criminal police, of April 4, 1938, Himmler defined as asocials those who demonstrate through behavior which is inimical to the community, but we needn't be criminal, that they will not adapt themselves to the community. The Kripo developed increasingly specialized branches to handle different types of socials, including homosexuals, drug addicts, abortionists and their clients, adulterers, and crime of opinion, constituted by the mere possibility of critical judgment about Nazism or any of its policies. This was coupled with a policy of crime prevention, which operated by sending potential criminals, ex-prisoners, beggars, prostitutes, and even the unemployed to prison or concentration camps. Of the 5,000 to 15,000 prisoners interned in concentration camps between 1936 and 1938, most were asocials rather than communists or political opponents in that period. And it is interesting because it was also a technology to combat unemployment, terrorizing the society. So if you were an unemployed person, you could be sent to the concentration camp. So the idea is you should accept any condition of labor, even without salary, very low salary, in order to avoid the possibility to be sent to the concentration camp. The organ by Himmler was to send 200 people each year from 1936 on, from each town and a percentage of towns and cities to the concentration camps if they were unemployed. So the third stage was the handicap. The Nazis simultaneously developed policies of persecuting physically and mentally handicapped people, which started with a sterilization law of July 14, 1933, and culminated in the murder of 70,000 psychiatric patients and handicapped children in the Action T4 operation between 1939 and 1941. And the fourth stage is the stage most known from June 1938 onward. Racial policies gradually predominated. So at first, this affected only against Jews and Gypsies, but after the German invasion of Poland in 1939, policies became increasingly anti-Slav, particularly with regard to the Polish population, and after the invasion of the Soviet Union in 1941, Russian prisoners. The Nazi organized pogrom of November 1938, the Kristallnacht, culminating in the arrest of between 20,000 and 30,000 Jews, 1,500 of whom were sent to concentration camps accused of being as socials. So the rest of the story is most known, how the extermination camps were created after 1941. But I'm more interested in this first period to understand how this technology of power works, because it is the most similar period compared with many other cases of genocide. I would say that the use of extermination camps to, as a tool of the industrialization of killing, it is something very particular of Nazism. But the main element of genocide is this use of the concentration camp system to terrorize population and to change identities. So in the immediate pre-war period, the Nazis saw the Jewish ghettos of Eastern Europe as the breeding ground of all of the Jews in the world. That is why they argued that to stop the Jewish was to stop communism. Central European Judaism in the late 19th and first half of the 20th century was in the eyes of the European bourgeoisie a subversive mode of identity construction, characterized by a culture that based decision-making and action on critical thinking. This was a culture that valued the rabbinical discussions in the Talmud and the ethical thinking of the Haskalah, the Jewish Enlightenment movement of the 18th and 19th centuries, which challenged Kantian ideas. Its assimilated versions were to be found in Marx, Freud, and Einstein, who had effectively deconstructed the scientific thinking of their time, and in the Jewish influence Marxism of Walter Benjamin, among others. In short, attempt to understand the Nazi genocide and the Wannsee Conference often lose sight of the preparatory stage that made genocide feasible. Without the concentration camps and the persecution that evolved in Germany between 1933 and 1938, the final solution to the Jewish question would never have been possible. Regarding concentration camps in Germany itself as a technology of power puts later events in a new light and allows us to evaluate what happened to the whole German society. One question that possibly requires a broad sociological understanding of the criminology of genocide is that of the different social functions served by modern genocides through this net of concentration camps. Because the objective of the net is the transformation of identity through terror. The idea of the rest of my presentation today is trying to explain how. The short answer to this question, how, would be through a sequence of interrogation, confession, and betrayal created by the Inquisition and perfected within the crucial institution designed for modern genocide, the concentration camp. And in some processes, there are no concentration camps, but there are ghettos that are prepared to do some of the functions of the concentration camp, but most of the modern genocide, we can find the concentration camps as the main institution to produce the terror through this sequence: interrogation, confession, betrayal. So the concentration camp system allows society as a whole to be persecuted and interrogated. This is possible because enemies of the state are defined in increasingly ambiguous and uncertain terms. Enemies of the Aryan race under the Nazis, intellectuals or new people under the Cambodian Khmer Rouge, subversive criminals under Latin American civil military dictatorship based on the national security doctrine, or terrorists under the new international, I would say, insecurity doctrines. The strangely ambiguous nature of the enemy places whole segments of the population under suspicion: students, unionists, intellectuals. In the ideal model implemented over the last 40 years, the whole population, including potential perpetrators, became suspects. Inquisitorial power, based on fear of the concentration camp, forced individuals to escape stigma through confession and betrayal of someone more visibly stigmatized than themselves. And that way used to divide the stigmatized groups in order to be accepted. And we can see this process in many societies, how this situation, that the stigmatization of whole segments of population and then trying to convince to some sector that there is a possibility they will be accepted if they accept the idea that the other groups are the groups who should be stigmatized. So in discussing the Inquisition, we can see as a genealogy of genocide the use of informers as a tactic for persecuting witches. Indeed, the whole system depended on denunciations. The main purpose of torture, apart from extracting a confession, was to force the victim to name another witch, creating the cycle of persecution and sacrifice. It is important to point out that the main purpose of this denunciation was to destroy solidarity among the persecuted. Much better point a finger at a possible witch or heretic before being accused oneself and stretched on the rack. The betrayal system was and is an effective tool for destroying the social fabric because it turns everybody into a potential enemy and leads individuals to moral depravity. Destroying the possibility of reciprocity through terror, the whole social fabric is transformed to guarantee discipline and obedience. To escape stigma, the suspect must pass the stigma to someone else. In Germany, Cambodia, Argentina, the former Yugoslavia, Rwanda, the state actively encouraged the population to denounce neighbors, co-workers, and even close relatives. This was done through media, education, and whispering campaigns, clearly describing the psychological operation manuals created by the French. These procedures were adopted by perpetrators worldwide. In Argentina, they inspired social textbooks on moral and civic training. It was a new chair in schools, and all the students had to read and to study this new chair, moral and civic training. And in Rwanda, they motivated continuous radio propaganda. This sort of widespread denunciation was a terrible but also highly effective way of reformulating social relations, since it prevented the possibility for mutual self-help or cooperation and became an automatic and almost unconscious behavior pattern typical of adaptive responses to terror. Recently, the classified Argentine documents, for example, clearly demonstrate that the explicit objective of the Argentine military juntas was to transform and reorganize the Argentine national group. Just one quote, file C51 on psychological operations. It was written in 1969, so I would say 4 to 5 years before the starting of the killing operation. This document details the importance of the use of terror and concentration camps to discipline and reorganize the whole Argentine population. The principles of psychological warfare are carefully defined as the following example shows, taking account, I will quote, but it was written by the generals. It is not a scholarly work. Take it in account. So, quote, compulsion is any action which tends to activate behaviors and attitudes by appealing to instinct. It acts on the instinct of self-preservation and other basic human tendencies called the unconscious. Compulsion almost always plays on fear. Psychological pressure of this kind engenders distress, massive and generalized anxiety may lead to terror, and that will be enough to place the target population at the mercy of any subsequent influence. So please forget this idea of savages, ignorant generals leading the Latin American countries, as it is in their Hollywood films. They have written this kind of text about how to use the terror and what are the consequences of terror as adaptive responses. We are humans. We are a very evolution way of animal that has adaptive responses in order to survive. And that's what genocide is using, to create change in our behavior. So the authors of this manual consider compulsive action as one of the priority modes of psychological warfare. Clearly, the Argentine perpetrators are not speaking of targeting specific political groups, but the entire Argentine national group. Partial destruction was a sine qua non for completely remolding society through terror. Indeed, the name they gave to the annihilation process was very accurate: process of national reorganization. It was no political reorganization, but a national reorganization, in which the main target was not the disappeared as such, however politically important many of the direct victims were, but the whole Argentine national group, which was reorganized through terror. The literature on the concentration camps and total institutions, such as psychiatric hospitals, emphasizes the deliberate and systematic destruction of personality that occurs in such places. It was described by Bruno Bettelheim and Primo Levi in the case of Nazism, by Pilar Calveiro in the case of Argentina, and even by the sociologist Erwin Goffman in the more theoretical and general book, Asylums, book from 1961, but a book I have recommend very much. It's a great book. And taking all of the testimonies of survivors and Goffman work in account, I have developed five main techniques applied in the concentration camp to break personality of the inmates. The first one is the ways of destruction of identity, so the destruction of our own self-esteem. Yeah. In both Argentina and Nazi-occupied Europe, the prisoner's name was exchanged for a number as soon as he or she entered a concentration camp. But loss of identity went beyond that. As Bettelheim observes, inmates were cut off from the references that defined their identity. Everything for which they were known, recognized, or stigmatized outside the camp was erased, from their professional to their social status, and they were denied all contact with friends or family. Within the concentration camp, their identity was determined only by the way they behaved within the camp. their response to torture and brutality, and their greater or lesser degree of collaboration. Faced with situations they couldn't even imagine before entering the camps, and for which they were psychologically unprepared, their self-esteem collapsed. The second technique is the annulment of perception and mobility. So while prisoners' previous identity was being erased, they were simultaneously prevented from recognizing their new environment. In the Nazi camps, detainees could be executed on the spot for trying to discover the camp's position and layout, or for monitoring the punishments meted out to other detainees. Survivors also describe how prisoners became cynical and apathetic, looking without seeing, incapable of responding ethically or reflecting on the environment or fate. In Argentina, sensory deprivation was taken a step further. On arrival at the camp or detention center, they disappeared, were blindfolded, or their heads were covered with hoods or bags, a treatment known as walling up, while their mobility was also restricted by shackles or threats. Moreover, communication between detainees was prohibited, and sometimes they couldn't even communicate with the perpetrators, except during interrogations. This combined effect of this procedure was social and physical disorientation, followed by a breakdown of personality. Feelings of panic were common in prisoners subjected to this condition for more than just a few hours. The victims plunged into total darkness, silence, and immobility tended to lose all track of time and space. Often, prisoners were stripped of all their clothing, which left the body not only in darkness, silence, and immobility, but also naked and vulnerable. The third technique was the role of torture, the initiation in the camp. If incarceration in a concentration camp involved restrictions on perception and mobility and loss of identity, initiation into concentration camp life was via torture. Inmates were subjected to beatings, asphyxiation, and a variety of physical punishments during their first hours and days at the camp as a way to breaking them in and getting them used to their new condition. The fourth technique are the processes of infantilization and animalization. The name were created by the own survivors, these techniques, to produce in the prisoners the possibility to lose control of their most basic human functions. They were forced to ask permission to urinate and defecate or to use a bucket inside the cell in which they were incarcerated. They had to request authorization to perform even the most basic tasks. Food, as well as being meager and of poor quality, was transformed into a sort of privilege for those who were considered well-behaved. Any activity, even the most trivial, was regulated by the authorities. Often, detainees were forced to behave like animals, imitating the sounds of dogs or cows, and crawling on all fours, or to go to the restroom blindfolded, which they would stumble into walls or doors, among other forms of humiliation. This loss of control of bodily needs, which are regulated externally by the perpetrator, was compounded by the spatial and temporal disorientation mentioned earlier, and the constant terror that torture could be resumed. And the fifth and last technique is the unpredictability. So finally, there was the impossibility of knowing how to save oneself. The ultimate fate, death, was both suggested and hidden. The manner in which behavior was evaluated was indecipherable. In some cases, torture lasted weeks, in others only a few days. In some cases, collaboration was rewarded with death. In others, it brought certain privileges. Acts of solidarity or defiance were punished with death or a visit to the torture chamber, but on rare occasions, they were tolerated and even respected. This contributed to the breakdown of personality, as various witnesses have testified. since it made it impossible to foresee the consequences of one's actions. Any action or inaction could result in death, but there was no pattern. Death was always just around the corner, and in the long term, seemingly inevitable. However, it was rationed in an arbitrary fashion, like the fool. In many cases, the prisoners' loss of previous identity and stable references and disconnection from their own feelings and perception, even from their own bodies, led to a complete breakdown of personality. Recalling his experience in book about concentration camp, Bederheim describes a figure that epitomizes the camp system even more than the living dead, namely the adapted man. This was a person who had accepted some or all of the perpetrator's values. An extreme example was a prisoner functionary or capo appointed by the Nazis to supervise forced labor or carry out administrative tasks in the camp. Most capos behaved with extreme brutality toward other prisoners. In the Argentine concentration camp, the adapted would be asked to talk to their companions or to work at detecting and identifying new victims to be brought in for interrogation. But, as most survivors point out, such cases accounted for only a minority of those who underwent destruction. Adaptation was encouraged both inside and outside the concentration camps, even though it didn't often go as far as direct collaboration or the transformation of the victims into perpetrators. Its purpose was perhaps simpler: the erasing of the rebelliousness or solidarity among the survivors of the camps, and more fundamentally, in society at large. So when we analyze the testimonies, it is interesting that most of the prisoners were not adapted. So some of them were living as what many prisoners used to call living dead. So they finally lost any possibility to continue doing what is necessary to live, not to taking food, not to moving, not to doing anything. But most of the prisoners, the majority of them, due to the testimonies, were subjected to some kind of schizophrenia, trying to demonstrate some kind of collaboration to be able to survive and sustaining in themselves the possibility to retain some parts of their identity. But I have learned a lot from the survivors. And in the case of Argentina, they were in some associations and they were trying to understand why they had survived. And they had no answer as any survivor in genocide because of this unpredictability of the system. So some of them cooperated a little bit, others don't. Some of them were more politically associated, but others don't. Some of them were younger, but others don't. So there was no reason to understand why some people were kept alive. And it is through our research, we can see that it is more and more people than we expected. So that this system of reorganization through terror needs some survivors. So the answers they gave to themselves after more than 10 years trying to understand was they needed us alive to spread the terror in society. For each one we touch, 1,000 paralyzed by fear. So if the state is saying, as Videla stated, the concentration camps don't exist, the disappeared people don't exist, so nothing is happening, how the society will be terrorized through this cynical situation, which your authorities are saying the concentration camps don't exist, but you know someone was there. And there is a problem with it. How can you trust in his testimony? Because the government is saying it is not such way. So probably, is he not exaggerating? Has he some political intentions trying to convince me about something that it is not so serious as he or she is saying? It is what most of the survivors of genocide used to suffer. The distrust about their own testimonies. The silence, but also the distrust. The situation is not so serious, the government is saying something different, we have no evidence about it. So this answer was terrible for them, because the idea, the following question was, what should we do? Because if we are not giving testimony, the process of persecution, the genocide, will be forgotten. But if we are giving testimony, we are terrorizing the society. So the decision was, and it is quite important, and I have learned a lot from that, the decision was, okay, we should give testimony, but not only testimony from the terror, or the terror, but testimony about our identity. They have tried to erase our identity from society. So it is much more important to talk about who we were than to talk about what happened to us. It is important to talk what happened to us, but in connection to who we were. What was the reason for which the state did us this kind of destruction? And it was a huge turning point, and I guess it was quite important to understand why the human rights movement was more successful in Argentina than in other places. Because from that moment on, the idea was, we can't talk only about the terror. Because the terror paralyzes, is what the perpetrators want. We talk only about a terror that no one can understand. Why the terror? There is no answer. Because people are crazy, because people used to be sad, used to be cruel, because who knows? The idea was to recover the identity. So by imposing terror on society as a whole, the concentration camp system aims to reshape the social fabric by creating a collective image of society as a nest of informers. It seeks to build a system of social relations in which the other is seen either as a possible traitor or the next person one should betray. The concentration camp system tends to create the sort of society that hopes to escape from. A society where man is a wolf to man in a civil war of all against all. And when each man can see the rest only as enemies, real or potential. His only possible ally is the punitive arm of the state, and he must seek his salvation in this Leviathan. Any counter-hegemonic model requires the support of tens or hundreds of thousands of people able to trust one another, to speak freely and have the courage to express their doubts. In contrast, one of the factors that make it so difficult to confront the inquisitor model of society is the paralyzing and debilitating nature of fear. A terrified population, convinced that everyone is a possible informer. Whether this be true or not is immaterial, needs all its strength just to ensure day-to-day survival. And that's important because it's not, the project is not to transform the society in a society of betrayers. They need less need only our conviction that the society is a society of betrayers. And that's why, in my opinion, the betrayal is so popular in the media in post-genocidal societies. The survivors used to say they were a minority. It was one in 100 who decided to betray, but in the media, the new. Important is the betrayal as the main behavior in the concentration camps. So reorganizing genocides creates societies of survivors, and society must learn to deal with the survivors' sense of threat. One important question, then, is the role criminal law and historical sociological analysis can play in helping to address such trauma. How can criminological concepts be used to obtain a deeper understanding of genocide-specific technology of power? And how is our knowledge production then used by survival societies to represent their own past and present, and to work through its consequences, trying to recreate a community? What the survivors in Argentina tried to do, to talk about not only their own identity, but the identity that was destroyed in Argentina, trying to recreate a community. And that community fight against the impunity, and that's my hypothesis about how and why the trials could be reopened in 2006, 2005. So these are some of the main challenges, in my opinion, for criminology in the future. The possibility to understand this terrible technology of power, and this possibility to understand as a fundamental tool to confront it. So that's enough for my side. Thank you.
Thank you very, very much, Daniel, for a chilling account of the technology of power that genocide employs, but also there's a sense in which there is a better story, and that of recovering identities and recognizing the identity that was targeted and has to be restored. So I'm going to open it up now for about 10 to 15 minutes for questions and contributions from the floor. Yes.
Hi, thank you so much for that talk. It was amazing. And I'm probably being very slow, but you talked about how, you know, in the concentration camps, there were released some survivors to sort of spread the message of terror. And I'm trying to reconcile that with genocide, which sort of in its truest form is the eradication of race. So could you, I'm probably not phrasing this very well, but like, could you explain how you go from that to genocide?
Yeah. That makes sense. Yeah, it is a fundamental question, and it has to do, probably you have read, and if not, you should read Jacques Semelan's work on genocide. It was published in 2006, something like that. He's a French scholar. And he tried to differentiate between this idea of eradication and what he calls subjugation, which is the way in which reorganizing genocide used to work. I think it's interesting, the connection, and it is interesting, the theoretical discussion. It was for the author of the concept of genocide was Raphael Lemkin, a Polish Jew, who understood genocide when he created the term as the way I'm explaining, as the destruction of national identity through the subjugation of the people. So he was not thinking about total eradication. He was thinking about that the identity that was destroyed, in his opinion, was the European identity, as a Pole, the Polish identity. Through the eradication, yes, of some groups in the society that were stripped out of that collective identity and plural identity. So the processes are intertwined. If you are only seeing the eradication, somehow, even unconsciously, you are thinking like the perpetrator. because you are seeing these groups as out of the general group. So as something essentially distinct from the general group. But that was the project of the perpetrator. It doesn't mean that the groups always have different characteristics. The Jews existed beyond Nazism. But it was Nazism which created some type of understanding of the Jews to be stripped out of the European identity. In other cases, it was even more clear in Rwanda. We can't find Hutus and Tutsis beyond 18th century. It was a colonial creation. They share the same language, the same tradition, the same religion, the same characteristics. And the only way to differentiate them is that Tutsis used to be taller. Yes, used to be taller.
Taller.
And yes, and there is explanation about, yes, because they came from the north and whatever, but it is very clear they are taller because they had better food for two or three centuries. And it is very clear with any people. Just go to Mexico and try to understand how these people who was, well, I don't know the system here in the UK, but it is almost 2 meters tall, and now we have the Mexicans with 1.5 meters. So difficult to understand why 3 centuries of malnutrition is enough. So the Tutsis were taller because they were the dominant class. That's the only reason. So there is no ethnic groups in Rwanda. They were created by colonialism, but it is very effective. Frank Chalk wrote a very important book, 1990, saying that it was used by many tribunals that the identity of this persecuted group that are being eradicated is created by the perpetrator. The only important element is to understand what is in the mind of the perpetrator. Because it's the one who decides that there are Tutsis in Rwanda. It doesn't matter if there are or there are not. If for the perpetrator there are Tutsis and they have these characteristics, they will be killed. But that's the idea. This eradication wants something more important, which is the transformation of the whole society through this eradication. That's why that's my main understanding of Nazism, genocide.
Thank you. I've got a question here and one at the back.
We can take.
Do you want two or three together? Okay. Here first and then at the back and then over here.
And thanks again for the talk. It was really, really great. And just following from your last point, which is about the reconstruction society as a whole and thinking about power and technology in a sort of positive light. Throughout, there was a sort of an absence of how the perpetrator here is constructed, and it's sort of, again, in how you just answered the last question, it's sort of almost as if the perpetrator is the natural figure within the society and the reconfiguration occurs around it. And I was wondering how you reconcile how the perpetrator is constructed as a positive, as a technology, as a result of a positive technology of power.
Okay.
Thank you. At the back.
Yeah, I was just wondering with that definition of genocide,
could you speak up a little bit? Sorry.
Sorry, with the definition of genocide that's focused on the destruction of identity, the classical definition, do you think that it could ever be interpreted to extend to the destruction of non-national identities, so the destruction of class identities or the destruction of gender identities? I was wondering if you thought that could ever become part of the genocide debate, and if there is only a focus on the category of the national, isn't that kind of falling into the trap of reinforcing the ideology of the perpetrator?
Thank you, and Ken.
Thank you. Well, I was going to ask a similar question because I was wondering whether there are any similarities with other mass killings such as Cambodia, China during the Cultural Revolution, the massacres carried out by the Japanese, of course the gulags as well. And possibly the most important one, the first one of all, which was the Armenian genocide of 1915, which unfortunately is denied even by some victims of genocide and by survivors of genocide from the Holocaust. So perhaps you could just comment on that.
Yeah. So, okay.
Do you want one more, or should we say it's three enough?
We can take one more.
Mike, and then I'll come back to you running the next round.
similar thing to some of the questions. I mean, I'm interesting that your understandings of agency and resistance in this situation. A lot of the writers on genocide focus on the sheer sort of overwhelming stripping away of rights. You know, Wilson about Auschwitz, Gambin's focus, Sosky's work on the absolute terror of the camps and so on. Seems to me what you're saying is that actually there actually needs to be the preservation of some agency or some capacity to survive, which is external to what the perpetrator is doing, in order for the further task of reorganisation to take place. So I'm just wondering whether you sort of see agency as being something which is still preserved, either consciously or unconsciously, by the act of genocide, or whether you see it in terms of being a form of resistance only.
I can take that. Okay, I'll start with the first three and then I will take the idea. So first, how the identity of the perpetrator is constructed and how it is included in this question is, it's very important, it's very interesting, but it is, the perpetrators are the ones trying to transform the identity of the society. So the problem is that this idea of reconciliation, which in Argentina, and I would say myself, clearly rejects, implies the idea that it is a reconciliation in the terms of the perpetrator, in the terms of the transformation of identity. So the identity of the perpetrators should be challenged. The identity, not the bodies of the perpetrators, but the idea is trying to recover the identity that was destroyed, or trying to recreate a community, we need to confront the identity of the perpetrators. So there is no possible reconciliation in the times of the destruction. To reconcile, the perpetrator should accept another kind of identity that it was not the identity that was created by them. So the whole society has to be transform. It's not enough that after the destruction, the perpetrators like to reconcile in these new terms with the victims. And probably there are no victims to reconcile with because their identity was changed. So that's, I haven't included directly the question because it is a challenge. It's a challenge to challenge this new model of identity. The second and third questions are very important, but it means it is fundamental to understand that by national, I don't mean ethnic. So what I'm saying, the partial destruction of the national identity, and that was also in Lemkin's mind, I include class identity, economic identity, cultural identity as part of the national identity. Our national identity is plural, not only ethnically speaking. And the main challenge for some of the cases, the third question mentioned, Cambodia, China, the Gulags, but I would say particularly Cambodia, it was that even if this technology of power, born in as a tool for capitalism, it was applied also to create socialist societies with this same system, and that was is really terrorizing. It's really, I would say, I don't have the word, but it's really terrible to think about the Cambodian experience. This, I would say, anti-Gramscian idea modified the society, not fighting for the ideas, for the mind of the people, but just killing all the people who are selfish. So that's how we will create a more cooperative society. And it was a nightmare. 1/4 of the population was killed in Cambodia. So that's why I think this idea of the partial destruction of the national identity is not the partial destruction of the ethnic identity. It's national in all the senses. And for the law, it's easier. Because the way in which the law defines the national identity is a tie with the state. The national identity is more concerned about the citizenship and about some kind of community that exists together. And it includes a lot of elements of your identity. So that was very clear in the cases of Latin America. They were not directed against ethnic groups. It was a decision to transform the national identity through patterns of behavior, through moral values, through even economic decisions. Regarding the case of Armenia, yes, it is particularly important because I would say it is a clear genealogy of the case, of the paradigmatic case of Nazism. And it is problematic why I have talked a lot with the communities that survived the genocide in modern Turkey. And it is problematic because they are following the same way of remembrance and creating of collective memories than the Jewish did after Nazism. And I guess it is a clear mistake because they are doing the same mistakes. So Nazism was so effective destroying the Jewish identity, and I could say that the Jewish identity was normalized after Nazism. And that's why they are not so, or we are not so persecuted as we were, because they were normalized. So now you have Jewish oppressors too. We had not until Nazism for 2000 years. So now we have. It is a common identity. So in the case of modern Turkey, particularly the Armenians, are following the same binary model in which the Armenians were never Ottomans, the Armenians are not Turks, the Turks killed the Armenians, this binary idea that the Germans killed the Jews. And it is really a pity, because I guess they lose the possibility to understand the plurality of the Ottoman Empire and the role of Armenians in that plurality. The first novel in the Ottoman Empire was written in Armenian. The Armenians were as fundamental for the Ottoman Empire culture as the Jewish were for the German culture. And it is interesting that there is a very important scholar working on the Armenian genocide, a Turkish scholar, Taner Açkan, who started one of his conferences saying, "My dear Ottoman compatriots," to the Armenian community in the United States. And I guess no one, or maybe a few people understood. Most of them were really angry against one of the few Turks scholars who recognized the Armenian genocide. He was expelled from Turkey, he was in jail. But he started his talk, "My dear Ottoman compatriots." This idea that the Armenian identity is part of my identity. That was the idea. And that was a very difficult idea to understand. And I would love not only the reconciliation of the Germans that we did something wrong, but a German saying, "My dear fellow Germans." That's the idea, to confront the genocidal thinking. Not only to say we did something wrong, killing you, but probably we should just expel you or just separating you from the society. Killing in extermination camp, it was enough. It was not enough. Too much. Yeah, it was too much. But this idea that to accept that you were part of our community, that's much more difficult. So the last question, I couldn't follow. Please try to redo it. Probably because of my English, but I couldn't follow your...
A lot of some of the more influential recent writers on genocide emphasized the destruction of agency within the camp.
Mm-hmm. Yes, that part I understood. And
agency is recognized, it's seen principally as desperate resistance, self-defeating perhaps, unwinnable circumstances, but you know, flickers of resistance, however they might protect mm-hmm. themselves. Sonderkommando.
Yeah.
Well, it seems to me what you're saying that there's another side to agency here, which is the capacity to survive and to be a survivor post that experience. But that this is also driven to some degree by the nature of genocide itself, which, as you say, requires survivors in order to achieve the final reorganization. So I'm just wondering if we can look at agency perhaps in a more complex, dialectical way, or ignore the framework. I think it's a very sort of unsighted and in some ways unsatisfactory view of agency. Extremely influential in this field at the moment.
Yeah. Now I understand your question, and I could say that yes, it's a problematic subject. I think that this agency of the survivors, of course, is in post-genocide societies. It is impossible, and I would say almost impossible, to resist in the own system of the concentration camps. But the problem is what happened to society after the genocide, and how to resist the goals and the objectives of the genocide in post-genocidal societies. But in that discussion, I totally disagree with Agamben about who is the witness. And I guess that I have written something, but it is in Spanish, unfortunately, it was not translated, analyzing that book of what rest of Auschwitz, I don't know how is the translation, the second volume of his trilogy, and his use of Primo Levi, because Agamben takes Primo Levi and quotes Primo Levi without taking account what Primo Levi says before the quote, what Primo Levi says immediately after the quote, and which book of Primo Levi is he taking. It is the last book, The Drowned on the Safe, and in the moment written just months before dying, possibly before committing suicide, and in a moment in which he felt that even his testimony was not enough. So I understand Levi, but to take Levi to say that even Levi was not the real witness, and the witnesses are the people who are no more with us, so delegitimizing the testimony of the survivors, in my opinion, is not only incorrect, but even a lack of respect for the victims. Because Agamben, who is no one, who never experienced a concentration camp, is saying, all of your testimonies are not real testimonies. So all of your testimony, the real testimony is the testimony of the people who are not here. So, and that's really problematic. And he's saying to Levi, it is possible that you committed suicide because you couldn't accept that your testimony was enough to explain your survival. So Agamben is saying, you were true. You were right. It was not enough. So you did good in committing suicide So in my opinion, it's absolutely disrespectful and incorrect because it is not true. When you have experienced that experience, if you can do something with that experience, that's quite important. And you are a witness. So I don't know if you have time for more.
How about we take one last batch of questions? So I've got Ronnie and Jonathan and the guy with the black t-shirt, and that will be the end of it. So three more questions. So Ronnie.
Yeah. Now these days we have IDPs which are like concentration camps, mm-hmm. like the Sutuyi IDPs there. And then they're in the process of genocide. It's not post-genocide now. In this era, process of genocide when they are victimized and they are alive and it's not the end of the stage, what can those victims can do?
Jonathan.
Thank you so much for your talk. It was chilling because the implications of turning the attention away from the activity of mass killing towards these other processes means that the idea of genocide can become to be seen to be quite our societies. So immediately I start reflecting on the processes that I've been witness to here in the United Kingdom, to the possible eradication of a kind of identity, which is a working class identity, during the course of the Thatcher regime. And we could see the consequences of that to some extent in the Hillsborough inquest. And that strikes me as being extremely interesting. I know read your book and appreciated it. How far do you actually take this concept? How far can you generalize it? After all, you do say, I think, at one point that you feel that genocide is endemic to modernism. It's actually to do with the process of modernization itself that these genocidal processes come out, and perhaps connected to the idea of states that are based on economic growth.
Mm-hmm. And the Hillsborough was a football disaster, football stadium disaster that the police were complicit in. So, yes, final question.
I'm just wondering, in post-genocide societies, and post-conflict societies, do you think that new legal protections like constitutions and bills of rights have any part to play in rebuilding collective identity or national identity?
Okay. So the first question is one of the difficult ones, because it used to happen that the people just ask, what can we do? And I know the Delphos Oracle system. I don't know how it's in English.
That's
the Delphos.
The Oracle.
Oracle. The Delphos Oracle says, I don't like this kind of presenters who think that they can answer all the questions of the world. So that's a difficult question. But I try anyway. I'm failing and saying probably I will fail, but I'll try. So your question is fundamental because it is not after genocide, which I would say it is easier, but it is another situation. But in the moment in which the genocide is being done, in which it is much more difficult, like in your situation. And I told you yesterday in Oxford that I think that when you analyze the stages in which the genocide is being developed, something that Iranians have used a lot, I used to say that the turning point is the isolation stage. So the fundamental task, if we analyze the genocidal processes as the one who were more successful and the one who failed somehow, I would say that the most important variable is the isolation. Can break the isolation, the genocide is much more difficult because the perpetrators need to isolate the groups to be able to kill them, because otherwise it's not economic, it is not possible, a lot of support. So this destruction of social ties between the stigmatized group and the rest is the fundamental task. So what the survivors, the members of the group, the people in solidarity with them can do is trying to break the isolation. In the ghettos, in the Jewish ghettos, the resistance was much more successful in the cases in which the resistance movement could break the isolation, at least the spatial isolation, but mainly the social isolation. So to make breaks with other groups that are being, well, it's the case in Myanmar, other groups that could be persecuted or are being persecuted, and trying to do some actions in common and trying to talk with the Myanmar community and trying to counterbalance this permanent propaganda against the group, and they are not part of our community, they were never here, and trying to work against that ideas and trying to continue working with the society is fundamental, because in the moment in the isolation is successful, probably the genocide will be done, the extermination process will be done very quick. So the second question is this idea of a process more general. I agree, but I would like to insist in the way that yes, the process of destruction of the social fabric using this distrust among the different people is really general. But I wouldn't call all of these processes genocide, because the specificity of genocide is that you are breaking the social fabric and creating this distrust through killing members, groups of the society. So it is specific way of destroying identity. But you are right that the same technology of power is being applied, sometimes without killings, but with terror. Many of my students used to ask me why this modern period in the Anglo-Saxon societies, genocide was committed against the colonies, against other people, but the little number of societies that suffer this kind of genocide in their own society. And I have no answer for a lot of time, but then I started to think that one possible answer is that this individuality, this weakness of the social fabric and social ties in some Anglo-Saxon societies was important. So to create this kind of technology of power, it was not needed terror, that means killing thousands or millions of persons. So that you can create the same, for example, and when you analyze the situation that way, maybe you can understand McCarthyism in the United States, not as a genocide, it was not a genocide at all, but yes, as a way to create the same technology of power. But how? Because to give you without your job, it was enough to create the same kind of behavior. I can say you that in Latin America, particularly in Argentina, to produce that you will lose your job, okay, take my job. So it was not enough. So the technology needs more and more terror to be able to be applied. And when you analyze the number of victims in the whole region in Latin America, it is not connected with the strength of the left-wing military arms. In some cases existed, but it is not connected with that. It is not connected with the level of revolutionaries that were in different societies, or if they were populist or communist, but it was connected with the strength of the social fabric. So in cases in which that social fabric was really strong, the number of victims was higher, which is the worst situation in the whole region, Guatemala. 250,000 victims, one-tenth of the population. Why? Because in Guatemala, this kind of political solidarity was in conjunction with the culture of the Mayan culture and a history of solidarity that was very difficult to break. That's why, in my opinion, the system needed more and more killings. So the question is fundamental, because at the end, I agree with you. Yes, it is the same technology. I guess that Sigmund Bauman have analyzed very well this other way of technology, is what he and Charles Taylor calls the ethics of authenticity. And it is very interesting to understand the second path, yes, the non-genocidal way to apply the same technology of power, but not in a genocidal way, just producing other kinds of distrust and betrayal. And the third question, it's difficult because my answer would be yes or no at the same time. If the constitutional Bill of Rights or this creation of new rights is a way to confront, and I would say no, it is not a way to confront the objective of genocide, because it doesn't mean any modification on the identity of the community. It is possibly a way to prevent some levels of terror. Yes, because if you have some rights, genocide was much more common in dictatorships than in democracies. It is not true that it didn't happen in democracies, but it was much more difficult. Why? Because this construction of rights. So I don't know how to say it in English. I'm trying to think about the world, but Bauman used to say it very well, Sigmund Bauman, when he says that one of the consequences of this post-genocidal era and this post-modernity was to put would be that way in English, to put down the roof of our utopia. So this idea of a community with equality, with equal, not only equal rights, but with the right to have a life somehow egalitarian and the possibility to enjoy the different goods for the whole of the society. So the roof was down, and now our utopia is just to be the right not to be killed. Important. But it is something different than an egalitarian society. But it is important. So that's why I'm saying yes or no. Yes, and it was a consequence. A consequence of Nazism was the delegitimation of racism. And it was important. And it was in that moment. We used to forget that until Nazism, racism was a very spread and accepted ideology and policy. In the 1920s, the sterilization campaigns were done in the United States. And when you read all the authors of the 19th century, all of them are racist. Even the more counter-hegemonic authors, Marx and Engels, are very important, I would say, not racist, but almost racist understanding and books. Why? Because it was so spread. So one of the consequences of Nazism was the delegitimation of racism and some laws against racism. It was important. So that's why my answer is yes, but on the other hand, it doesn't recreate the community. It's the same as some kind of reconciliation. It's in the terms of the perpetrators.
Right. Well, I think that we'll end this marvelous session. I think we, all of us in this audience, Daniel, will feel a very sort of special privilege to have been witness to this lecture this evening. I think few of us will have listened to something so powerful and so transformative. So I want to thank you very, very deeply for Queen Mary, the International State Crime Initiative. I'm lost for words. But thank you so much. And so if you can join, thank you. And we have a small gift from the International State Crime Initiative. This is a book produced by one of our distinguished visitors last year, Greg Constantine, the Rohingya photographer. And Greg has played a huge role in documenting statelessness and genocide throughout the world. And so this is for you, Daniel, and thank you very much. And we're just so delighted to have you. But I wanted, just before we retreat to a reception, drinks and refreshments, I want to thank Louise Wise and Kevin Warne, who did a fabulous job in organising this evening, to Fatima, who initiated, and Tom, this wonderful, we're learning from Zani, so that's a great thing. And I want to thank you all for coming, and a special thanks to the law school, to Valsama Smitsalagas, because the law school funded this event and brought Daniel over. And so we're absolutely thrilled to be here, Queen Mary, but also to have the resources that you make available, that we can have such wonderful, brilliant speakers here. So thank you all very much. Sorry, there's... Oh my goodness. And I forgot to thank Wayan. I'm sorry, you're hidden there, Wayan, and out of sight, out of mind sometimes. I'm terribly sorry. Wayan is an intern for the International State Crime Initiative, and he has served us so beautifully on every public occasion. Thank you so much, Wayan. You get a very special thank you now. Thank you, Fatima. Okay, refreshments at the top of the stairs. Thank you all very, very much, and thank you.